have your Bibles with you, I'd ask you to turn to the Gospel of John. While you're turning there, I always desire the prayers of the church. I believe the Lord hears them specifically. John chapter 21, and we're going to begin reading in verse 24. John 21, the last chapter, beginning in verse 24. This is the disciple which testified these things and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true. And there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written, everyone, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and watch care. Lord, we thank you for your mercy and grace. Lord, we thank you for the strength that you granted that brought us here this day. Lord, we know that it couldn't be without you. Lord, we pray that you would somehow, that you would meet with us. Lord, we know that you can, and we know that we've experienced it in times past. And Lord, that you would meet with us today. Lord, we pray that you might convict sinners. Lord, that you would encourage those of yours that are here, that we might go on in victory, Lord, and not live in defeat. We pray these things in the sweet and the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right, we'll be preaching today on the thought, just a typical day. Just an everyday day that everybody has, an everyday day when the Lord Jesus meets with us, and every day in the life and the glory that is found in Christ Jesus. Now, I'll say for this, our typical day, we do not appreciate. Our average every day, we've come to the point we just take for granted. Now, I do believe that very soon we'll appreciate them more because they'll be taken away from us. And the privileges and the freedoms that have been granted by God Almighty will be swiftly taken away, even in a moment. And then when we no longer can meet, and we can no longer do what we are blessed with today, when it's gone, then we'll appreciate a typical day. Now, we'll go to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1. And we'll begin reading in verse 20. Matthew chapter 1, beginning in verse 20. The Bible says, "And while he," meaning Joseph, the earthly father of Jesus, "and while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And they shall bring forth she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save the people from their sins. Now this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child." Now, I want you to see that as the Lord is really beginning his earthly life, when he was transformed into a babe and placed in the mother of Mary, that became a typical day. It is a miraculous day, it's a glorious day, but just a typical everyday day with Christ. Now, I want you to see the first thing he accomplished was that he spoke to Joseph in a dream. That was just a typical day back then. If you'll follow the prophets, that many, many times the way the Lord spoke was through a dream. Now, we don't have that today. Between the Word of God and the Holy Ghost, we don't need that. But in that day, it was a typical day. Can you imagine the glory and the blessing of having a dream and the mighty God of all heaven, Jehovah Jireh, speaking to you through a dream? A typical day, an everyday occurrence, because God is who He says He is. Now, I want you to see another thing. Joseph, like many of us, he had to remind him, fear not. Just a typical day.
Yeah.
Now you think about your typical day, and if we'd be honest, there's many, many, many days that we're fearful. There are many days that we don't think, well, and we certainly don't. We don't know what will be next, but God does. We don't know how the election's going to turn out in November, but God does. In fact, I fully believe He predestinated it from the world began. So why do we get worried? You know what? We don't need to fear. This is just a typical day. This is just an everyday, another day in the hand and in the control of a sovereign God. Now I want you to see next, He says, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus." Now, we have a challenge of that today. These messianic Jews, falsely so-called, come up with different names. But you know what the Bible says? His name was Jesus. Now, I'll dare say that most people don't know the meaning of it. Jesus means Emmanuel, God with us. Present, living here with us, Emmanuel, Jesus is His name. And there's nothing wrong. The next time somebody says He needs to be called something else, say no, His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. And we should not get upset about that. We should thrill in the fact that He met with us. Now this is just a typical day. God being incarnated in the flesh and meeting with His people. A typical day in the eyes, in the lives of a child of God. Verse 23, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child." You know what? In man's idea, that's an impossibility. In man's ideas, and you know, there's been every kind of effort through artificial insemination to repeat this miracle, but it hasn't been done. It is impossibility to be done in man's eyes, but in God, it's a typical day, an everyday occurrence. Seeing that He's under His dominion and control is the birth of children, the creation of a new life. Can you imagine serving a God that's just a typical day? You know what? We don't serve Him enough. We don't glorify Him enough. We don't understand a typical day is a great blessing. Every day God meeting with us. Every day God giving us breath of life and air to breathe in and health enough to get up and get going. That's a typical day that we take for granted. That we say, well, just another day. Oh no, a boo-hoo. And never give Him the praise that's due His name. A typical day. Gospel of John chapter 2. We see the Lord in one sense a little prematurely, at least in man's eyes, starting His ministry at the request of His mother. The Gospel of Matthew chapter number 2, beginning in the very first verse. Gospel of Matthew chapter number 2 in the first verse, the Bible says, "Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem." I'm sorry, go read the Gospel of John. That's a good scripture, but I don't want to read it just now. Gospel of John chapter number 2. John chapter 2 in the very first verse. The Bible says, "And the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus was called and His disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, they have no wine." Now I want you to see, this in one sense was an atypical problem. In that day, when the wedding was there, it was a feast, sometimes of several days, and the beverage they drank of was wine. Now, people want to taboo that today and say, oh no, it was grape juice. No, it was wine, alcoholic beverage, just like you and I think of when we hear the word wine. Now, the reason they drank it wasn't to get slot drunk. The reason they drank it is because it was pure and that their water was putrefied with disease. And so, because of that, they drank wine for the cleanliness of it. And so, we find here that in an average wedding, you would put out the very best you had. The things most precious to you. The things that was to be viewed of all and to be looked on and to be enjoyed as your daughter is getting married or your son. And Jesus saith unto her, Woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. In other words, my ministry is not started. I'm not yet to be the focus of attention. John is still finishing the work that God gave him to do. My time is not yet come. But Mary, knowing the power of Christ and knowing the power of his that he was very God in the flesh, she says, Whatever he do, telleth thee do it. Ordinary day becoming miraculous, becoming glorious, becoming something more, far more than the average. You know what? You look at the Mary, the mother of Jesus, and the confidence she had in him. It makes you wonder if she didn't experience other things at other times. How could she know that he could do this? How could she know that whatever he said would be done because of his power? I don't know. Maybe she had seen some other things because we just read. If it was all written down, we wouldn't know what the world itself couldn't contain of all the typical days in the life of Christ. But she did. We do know this. She had full confidence in him. Verse 6. And there was set there 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. Now what these were for, and if you know, they had not only embellished the law, because they were in the law taught to wash their hands. See, God had given that. Before we knew what a bacteria was, God was protecting his people from it. Now, what they had added to it is you do it 3 times during the meal. What really all it was to be washed your hands and clean up before you eat. But you know, like most people today, they had to add a little self into it. Had to add something. Well, you know, if one time's good, 3 times it would be really good. Right? And so they had these water pots really for just washing the hands during the meal. Something inconsequential, something really, if you think about it, was dirty. Now, if they all came down and washed their hands as they were supposed to, at the very least, there had to be foodstuffs in them. You know what? In that day, they didn't have a knife and a fork and a spoon. They ate with their hands. And they did get dirty. One thing we still today, even today, we eat with our hands. And if you really study it out, is the right way to do it. We eat fried chicken with our hands. Now, we know that halfway through, a lot of times, we get our napkin and wipe it off and it gets greasy on our mouth. It gets greasy on our hands. Now, that's what these pots were for. They were dirty. And so God can make something wonderful out of something dirty, can he not? Amen. When he saved your soul, he did that. Yeah. When he spoke life to you, that's exactly what happened. And so they had the dirty water pots, they had them sitting there. And Jesus saith unto them, Fill the water pots with water. And they filled them up to the brim. And he saith unto them, Draw out now. Bear unto the governor of the feast, and they bear it. Now, I want you to notice a couple of things. Further, first of all, was the faithfulness of the people who did it. Now, if you want to enjoy a typical day, you've got to have a little bit of faith. You have to have a little bit of confidence in the person of Christ. You have to have a little bit of belief about you if you really want to have a typical day in the life of a child of God. You can't go about with your hands being wringed and worrying what's going to be next. Worrying if God is able to do this. You know what? I'll say this, he's very able. He's very, very able. Now, one thing it doesn't say as well, it did not say that it changed color. Did you ever think about that? It didn't say that it started being purple. It didn't say that it started being red. It says, you just get your cup of this and bear it to the master of the feast. Now, I don't know when it became wine. I don't know when it became the best drink that was at the feast. But I know that it took some faith to take a cup of dirty water and bear it to the master of the feast. You know what? If you want a good, typical day, you have that confidence in the person of Christ. You have that confidence in the God of all heaven. And you'll have a typical day. It'll be a good day. It'll be a glorious day. And so we know that they did. And when they arrived there, when they got to the place of the feast, that the governor of the feast says this, verse 9, and when the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servants which drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and saith unto him, every man at the beginning doeth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse, but thou hast kept the good unto now. Now, I'll give you a little twist on that and give you some thought for the week. Yeah. See, John's ministry was about over. Mm-hmm. And the good stuff was coming. Mm-hmm. Not that there was anything wrong with John. John certainly completed his defined, designed purpose. But see, Christ was much better.
Amen.
Christ was much better.
Amen.
So he was predicting, listen, the good stuff's coming.
Right.
The very best is on its way. That was really good, but now the very best has come to meet with you. See, if we want a typical day where the water is turned to wine, then we're going to have some faith. I'll say this, and we'll move on. Do you believe God's still able?
Amen.
I am the Lord, I change not.
That's right.
You know what? I fully believe with faith we could pick up a cold glass of water and before it hit our lips, it'd be good wine. But what the problem is we lack faith. We lack the ability to initiate. And so we see here that the Lord Jesus does a wonderful, miraculous thing for these people. He does a glorious thing on a typical day. Go with me to the Gospel of Matthew now, back to chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 22. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 22, the Bible says, and they immediately left their ship and their father and followed him. Now, if you know your Bible, you know that this is the calling of Peter and James. And he says, you come with me. Come with me and I will make thee fishers of men. And it says, and immediately they left their nets. And this was the hard one. And their father. See, we don't know how old their father was at this point, but we know he was old. Because the reason I know he was old is they were adults. They were done involved in the father's business. They were he was at least my age, if not older. And so, if we want to serve him, we're going to have to quit worrying about father. You see what I'm saying? We're going to have to quit worrying about the ordinary, what this world has to offer, and we're going to have to follow Christ and what he's given us to do. You know what? That is what the Lord teaches us to do. In fact, the Bible says, if you hate not father, and hate not mother, and yea, even your own life, you have no part with me. That's pretty stout stuff, is it not? Now, we skim over that and like, oh, well, yeah, that's good. And you know what? It is almost, if we don't get this flesh into subjection, it is almost an impossibility to hate yourself. It really is. Even the vileness and the worldliness and the lewdness of the flesh, it is very hard to hate it when it comes to you. And so we see the calling of the two men. And the Bible says that immediately they left the ship and their father and followed him. And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. And so we find a typical day is this: preaching, teaching, and healing. Now, this is the thing. If Peter and Peter and James had no faith, they couldn't have seen it. If they hadn't left daddy and left the fishing business behind, they would have never seen Christ Himself preach. And they certainly would never have seen the healed, the sick healed. And that was a typical day. You know what? After 3.5 years, they had seen it all. After 3.5 years, certainly they learned that illness and disease and even death was under the feet of Jesus, was under His authority, that nothing challenged Jesus. You know why? That's just a typical day. That's just an everyday occurrence in the life and the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I will say this with caution. Don't get used to it, because He can take it away. Verse 24. The Bible says, "And His fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto Him all sick people that were taken of divers diseases and torments." Now, I like that the King James divides the two between diseases, meaning physical health, and torments, meaning mental health. You know what? You can get so down and discouraged it's nothing but a torment, that even getting up out of bed, it's not worth it. You know it's going to be another day of defeat before your feet hit the floor. That's a torment. That is so much discouragement. But seeing that, you know what? I would love to know how He put that away. Now, we know some specific healings. As He was healing the lame man, the Bible says that his feet received strength. He brought him on up. How do you relieve somebody of torments, the anguish of the past, the mistakes you've made? I can't, and you can't, but Christ can.
That's right.
See, the torment was there. The torment was present, and He got rid of it. Can you imagine somebody so depressed and so down and out, and Christ speak to them, and they're ready to serve Him for the rest of their life? That is, you know what? They seen that on a typical day. On an every day, they saw people relieved of their own torments. And those that were possessed with devils. You know what? Those that are possessed with devils is still a very, very real thing. Remember the maniac of Gadara, of whom was cast out? One gospel says many devils. The devil, the group of devils said, "We are legion, for we are many." Many, many, many in one individual. And seeing them just, what'd He say? He says, "You come out of him. You come out of him." See, Christ's authority exceeds the devil's authority. Now the Bible says He is the prince and the power or the authority of the air. But Christ's authority exceeds that. It's above that. That's the reason He can say, "Get thee hence, Satan, for thou an offense unto me." And so we find that these men, on a typical day, saw the power of Christ illustrated time and time and time again. And those which were lunatic. Now, our modern day for lunatic, and it is a clinical term, is mentally ill. Mom had a sister that was tormented with that the entirety of her life. Could you imagine somebody just coming by and healing her? I mean, if you've really ever seen, and I'm not talking someone who becomes confused with age, because that happens to the best of us, but someone who's truly crazy. I mean, that hears voices and they're real to them. That hears voices that commands torment. Kill your mom. Kill your mom. Kill your mom. That's a real thing. These people are a lunatic. And could you imagine on a daily basis, these people that are just fully crazy, Christ just saying, it's over with, it's done. And all that torment gone. In a single speaking in the world. See, they saw that a typical day. You know what? Sadly enough, as much as I've been in healthcare, I've saw mentally ill people get better, but I've never seen one healed. If you don't believe that, let them get off the medicine for about a week and you'll find out that it's still there.
Yeah.
It's still present. And those that had the palsy, and healed them. Palsy. Don and I's adopted daughter Anna. She has a true palsy. She cannot walk. She does good to feed herself. She's dependent for everything. Can you imagine, those of you that remember Anna, to say, Anna, get up. You're good. Her to hop up and begin to tend for herself. See, that was a typical day. Everyday occurrence. Those of you who know Anna, if she walked in that back door, you'd be on the floor with surprise. But just a typical day. Just an average, everyday. Seeing those that were sick with the palsy rise up and begin to praise God to give glory and honor. We find a man that was, the Bible said, had been laid at the gate for 38 years. Get up and praise God and go through the temple and give Him glory. We find a blind man who finally came to the end of it. They wanted him to blaspheme the name of God. And he says, I don't know what you're talking about, but I do know this. I was blind and now I can see.
That's right.
A typical day. Everyday occurrence with Christ. A typical day. We fail to realize how good He is to us. We fail to realize what a blessing He is in our life. We fail to realize what He does on a routine basis. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 8. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, verse 41. Luke 8, verse 41, the Bible says, and behold, there was a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue, and he fell down at Jesus' feet and besought Him that He would come into his house. Now, I want you to notice a couple of things, as we sometimes let the context of it go, and we don't really understand the full gravity of the situation, but I want you to see one that was very prideful, one that was very much a ruler, one that knew, you know what? He may have even been one that criticized the ministry of Jesus, because remember, the Jews in the synagogue, they didn't want anything to do with Him. They were better. This can't be the man. He's a liar. He's not the Christ. And then we find Him at the feet of Jesus saying, my daughter's sick. You know what will bring everything even? When the baby's sick. When there's no thought whatsoever and knowing full well that you can do nothing. And you know what? It don't matter how old they are. All mine, Bella's grown now. And when they're sick and I feel like there's nothing I can do, it's a very wavery feeling. When Judy was sick, Mom in her late 70s still wanted to do something, but there was nothing she could do. That was Jairus. All he had left was to lay at the feet of Jesus and say, will you please do something? That's us too. Now, we don't like to put ourselves in that position, and we don't like to assume the position of a beggar, but that's exactly what we are. We find Jairus do that very easily. And he said, for he had only one daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay a dying. But as he went, the people thronged him, or slowed him down, and pressed against him. And a woman having an issue of blood 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, came behind him and touched the border of his garment. And immediately the issue of her blood staunched. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" See, the reason, the difference is, there was a bunch that thronged him, that kind of shoved him, that kind of pushed on him, but they had no faith. You know what? I believe there's a lot of people today just touching all over Jesus, but they lack faith. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They lack faith. We find one little woman with an issue of blood. You know what? There was a day in my life that I had an issue of blood. And that was this, that sin was all over me. And if you've not been born again, you know what? You still have it too. And the issue of blood will always manifest itself. You can see it on people. You know what? When you have liver failure, you know why you become yellow? Some of you healthcare people, you've seen that. It's because there's poisons carried on the blood, and it takes it to your skin. Is that not an issue of blood? Right? And so we find then that we, as the Lord, before the Lord saves us, we as sinners, we have an issue of blood, and it's displayed in everything we do, how sinful we really are, how we reject the Son of God, that it becomes an obvious thing to all of those that are around us. And the rest of verse 45, when all denied Peter and they that were with him said, "Master, the multitude thronged thee and pressed thee, and sayest, who touched me?" And Jesus said, "Somebody touched me, for I perceive that virtue is gone out of me." And when the woman saw she was not hid, she came trembling and falling down before him, and she declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. Now, I never really understood why this woman was so quiet. But when you think about it, you are too. God gives us great things every day, and we never say anything. You know what? This morning, my old right hip was hurting. But I got up, my feet hit the floor. And you know what? I was able to walk to the front room. I was able to pick up my Bible. I was able to open the pages. Or just said, "Blessed be the name of the Lord. Another day that I can do something for myself." You know what? You go down here to the nursing home, yeah, and you walk around a little bit, and when you leave that place, you'll be glad of some things. You know, a lot of people, I don't like nursing homes. Well, I'll give you this. It's not just the odors. It's not just seeing people in that shape. The real thing is imagining yourself in that shape. Mm-hmm. That's why people don't like them. Mm-hmm. And so we see then that this woman, she came and then she confessed it. Don't get down on the woman with the issue of blood, because you know what? It has to be pretty bad stuff for us to give praise to God. It has to be out of the ordinary. But this was a typical day, a day in the child of God. Verse 48, and he said unto her, "Daughter, be of good comfort, thy faith hath made thee whole." And while he yet spake, there cometh one from the ruler of the synagogue's house, saying to him, "Thy daughter is dead, trouble not the master." Now, have you ever thought about this woman, Jairus, as they're coming along the way, and here comes this woman, and they can't move that fast anyway because the crowd's just throwing him. And then Jesus just stopped and said, "Who touched me?" And then everybody was like, "Wasn't me, wasn't me." That woman came trembling. You know what that did? It took some time. I'll say this, Jairus never said, "Hurry up, Jesus, we've got things to do." We want to hurry Jesus up, don't we? You know what? When he'll act and he will move is when he gets ready. And so when this big incident was over, we don't know how much time it took, there came one and said, "Jairus, she's dead. Trouble not the master." You know what? That ends. Death is the end, and the horrible end that most people think about. If you have never seen someone die, take up the opportunity and watch them. We need to see that. I saw my father die. You know what? It took on a brand new experience. I don't even know how many people I have watched die. I really couldn't tell you. But it was through brand new eyes when I saw my father die. It was through brand new eyes when I walked out of Judy's room and knew I would never see her on this side of eternity again. Took on brand new. And you know why? People don't like their own mortality. Well, let me tell you this. The end is coming. The end is coming. If Christ doesn't return in my lifetime, you know what? My end is coming. I'll be done. You know what? Blessed be the name of God. I don't fear death. I really don't. Sometimes I might think about, well, you know what? Everybody in my family that I know of that's dead died with cancer except for Billy, and somebody shot him. You know what? I think it's a pretty good likelihood that one day I will be full of cancer. You know what? Blessed be the name of the Lord. I fear that. I don't want to go through cancer. But you know, if that's the way God has for me, blessed be the name of the Lord. And so we find that Jairus gets the bad news and says, "Listen, don't even trouble the master anymore. She's dead. It's done with. Nothing else can be done." But notice what Jesus said. When Jesus heard it, he answered him, saying, "Fear not. Believe only." You know what? That's the same thing as faith. You know why we don't have good typical days? Is we lack faith. We lack belief. We lack confidence in the person and the ability of Christ. "Fear not, believe only, and she will be made whole." And while he came into the house, he suffered no man to go in save Peter, James, and John, and the father and the mother of the maiden. Five people. You know what made this an especially nice day? Five people out of so many that thronged him. You know why you don't have a good typical day most of the time? It's your fault. Don't blame Christ. Don't blame Jesus. Don't blame me. Blame yourself, because that's where the... You know what? I bet it took a whole lot of faith for Jairus to keep going. You know what dead is? Dead is dead. I picked up bodies that were done stiff. Dead is dead. Right? Does our Heavenly Father and the person of Christ have dominion over that? You bet He does. If He can bring out a man that was done rotten and stinking, He can do whatever He wants to do. That's the person of Christ. You know, have you ever thought of these five people? Would you have been one of them? You know, he was very selective. He put out everybody else and said, you know why I believe these five got it? I believe they got to see it. It's because they had faith. They believed Christ was going to do it. I believe they were excited. Man, I've never seen anybody dead and come back to life. I've never seen a little child that's lost their life. And they're going to raise up again. And they're going to say hello. They're going to be all around again. I've never seen that. I want to see it. You think the Lord Jesus Christ still saves? I have faith that He does. I believe that He does. I want to see it. Do you believe that Christ, that God still sends revival? I have faith that He does. See, faith will move you to do things that otherwise you would not do. And so these five individuals, a select few, just a few out of that huge throng of people, they got to go in. They got to see it when everybody else didn't. When nobody else got the privilege, they were the ones to do it. Verse 51, and when he came unto the house, he suffered no man to go in, save Peter, James, and John, and the father and the mother of the maiden. And all wept and bewailed her, but he said, weep not, for she is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn, knowing that she was dead. And he put them all out, and took her by the hand, and called, and saying, maid, arise. And we know she gets up. And she does exactly what Christ bids her to do. And he even says, give her to eat. And so we find that that's a typical day in the life of an apostle. And we don't know how many others, except for Jairus and the widow's son. Jairus' daughter and the widow's son and Nicodemus. We don't know how many that he called from the dead, but we know that he can and that he does and that it's under his dominion. Many years ago, I didn't see this. I think maybe Donna did. At the nursing home, there was a gentleman that died. And the nurse called the funeral home, called Dr. Lee, and they went down to clean him up, prepare for Mr. Anglin. And he had drainage and stuff, so the nurse, Juanita, began to suction his mouth. And he caught, white and cold, and he caught that suction with his mouth. And then he went, and he lived three more. The funeral, the hearse arrived, and they said, hey, we don't need you. See, that's what my God can do. He's the timer of death. Man is not. He's the one that has it under his dominion. Just a typical day. My typical day goes like this. I get up a little before 6. Shower, I dress, grab my Bible and my lunch, and I head out to work. I drive down the road to Clarksville, about 45 minutes. I try to meditate on the things of the Lord. Sometimes other things get in the way. Try to listen to gospel music, and arrive at work, usually before anybody else. And I unlock the health care department, and I go to my office, and I sit there and prepare for the day's lecture. You know what? That's a sad, typical day. I lecture, test my students, drive home, go in the house usually, sit down, eat a bite. Usually that's it. Sometimes I might do something else. That's a pretty sad, typical day. Don't you think? So, I don't want to criticize my pastor. Well, I'm telling you, that's a sad, typical day. Ever wonder what would happen if I walked down the halls of the school and said, "Blessed be the name of God, that great God, Jehovah Jireh. Blessed be the name of His dear Son, Christ. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Now that'd be a good typical day, wouldn't it? That would be a typical day if we trusted Him as we should. That would be a good typical day. Finding someone to share the glorious gospel to with, that's a good typical day.
Man.
You know what? We need our typical days to be better.
That's right.
We need our typical days to be less full of the world and more full of Christ. We need our typical day to be centered on the things of God. You want something more than the normal? Begin to trust Him. Remember the two things? It says of Jairus, he believed. And it says of the widow, the woman who was healed of the issue of blood, thy faith had made thee whole. Reason Peter and James left Daddy, Bible says they had faith. They moved on. What about you? Do you have faith? Do you want to see something more than the typical? Donnie, you come and watch.